The look of love is in.
Part of her attraction was that she was a white girl who could sing that fabulous black R&B music, and it crossed over because that's what I loved. So that to me was yes, yes, and that was what girl power was, you know, in the 60s.
The only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man.
I think Dusty does sum up the kind of fabness of the 60s with her voice and also with the hairdo, the kind of bouffant hairdo. And of course, the trademark eye makeup made her very, very iconic.
I think I'm going back to the thing.
There was this vulnerability about her voice and her, I think, her personality, which attracted me to her. And I think that's what attracts the public to great singers and personalities from show business, is their vulnerability. You know, they're waiting for them to crack open at any second.
Dusty Springfield, that's a pretty name. It even sounds like a game. In a green field, hobby horses play the dusty game when it's May. Pink and paisley skies, shining in green eyes, a magic pinwheel. London flowers fair, blooming in her hair. Dusty Springfield.
Thank you.
Since the death of Dusty Springfield in March 1999, just short of her 60th birthday, fans and musicians have continued to celebrate one of Britain's greatest ever singers.
You don't have to say.
Born Mary Isabel Catherine O'Brien to Anglo-Irish-Scottish parents, she became the original 60s Brit girl, the so-called white negress, a gay icon, a diva.
I'll never try
till I do all I see.
Over a career spanning four decades, Dusty's glamorous image was to be as much her hallmark as her voice, but it masked a deeply private person. Dusty herself was torn between two different characters, Mary O'Brien, the plain, insecure redhead, and Dusty Springfield, the star she created. A household name, she both invited attention and shunned it. This is the story of the Dusty we thought we knew.
Song, it's "Oh Lord, Please Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood." It's absolutely, I'm the most misquoted and misunderstood person I know, really, honest.
Here she comes, here she comes.
Dusty hated work of any sort, so she hated singing, she hated performing. Motivation was money. It was a means to an end. It was the only thing she could think of that she could do to make any money, you know? And so she had to sing.
See all her face there.
I think she sang because she needed to be loved for who she was, and she was never sure. She didn't trust herself, and she didn't trust anybody, and she never trusted her own ability to sing and to move and to touch people.
I'm looking for someone of the gentle kind, no one that looks can lie.
Basically, she was very shy. On stage, I don't know what happened to her because she became another person. I'd see her before she went on. She used to go red all the way down here with sheer panic about getting on in front of the audience. She couldn't find things. She'd be nervous. She'd be tripping over. You know, is this right? Is that right? Have I got this? Have I got that? She'd walk on the stage and there was the star.
Look at her now, babe. She needs love so much more somehow.
She used to call him somebody else. I mean, Dusty was Dusty Springfield and she was Mary O'Brien. You know, there was two people. I mean, she transformed as soon as the fingernails went on and the and the hair was done and everything. That was Dusty. And she became Dusty then. And she was definitely two people.
As an 11, 12, 13-year-old, I was pure St. Trinians. Sheer horror. The hockey sticks, the works, round glasses, Panama hat, just a disaster area. And then I guess it was really an overnight thing that I decided I must change. I realized that this person that was looking at me in the mirror was not going to make it. I just decided I wanted to be someone else. So I became someone else. Now I'm trying to find the other one.
See?
At convent school, Dusty shocked the nuns by declaring she wanted to be a blues singer. After playing the London folk clubs with her brother Tom, the 19-year-old Dusty joined vocal harmony trio, the Lana Sisters. In 1960, Dusty rejoined her brother Tom to form the Springfields. Third member Tim Field was replaced in 1962 by Mike Hurst in time for their biggest British hit, Island of Dreams.
Was aware immediately how great her voice was compared to the other female singers of the day, 1962-63, quality of her voice was unique. I mean, that was the whole thing. I mean, Tom used to say all the time, just smile. And he hated it anyway, but he had this sort of fixed smile on his face, and it never left his face, it never changed. So that's the way it was. It was very, very M.O.R., very cabaret. And that isn't what Dusty wanted.
Get ready to be right on. something. Can't you see that ever since we met you've had a hold on me? It happens to be true. I only want to be with you, yeah. It doesn't matter where you go or what you do. I want to spend each moment of the day with you. Oh, look what has happened.
Dusty the solo singer burst onto the scene in 1963 and was an immediate success. But her rise to stardom was not without its difficulties.
I only want to be with you, yeah. You start to smile at me, ask if I care to dance.
Dusty Springfield, this is somebody else, you know. Basically, I'm quite a shy person, so to take on the mantle of a performer is not an easy act.
She had to go on stage and be this big, strong, stroppy woman who had so much power and could stand up on stage and captivate thousands of people. But then when she would go home and close the door, she was that scared little girl, because that's basically what she was.
I mean, I identified with her in that situation. She was very, very insecure about the way she looked, had very great self-doubt. But that sometimes makes a great artist, you know, that insecurity and that. You know, people think, you know, the glamorous Dusty that they saw on television, but that wasn't probably the real her at all.
I think she saw Dusty Springfield as a creation in many ways, and a creation that took a long time to dress up in. You know, getting ready to be Dusty took many hours. She would have looked great in half an hour, I'm sure. But her insecurities were in charge, you know, and maybe a little bit of obsessiveness too.
She really went through it to be beautiful, you know, because she was small. She was only, 5'3". So to have to wear high heels, but not too high, because she didn't want to look stupid walking around in really spiky heels. And his hair piled up, and people said, does she ever take the makeup off? She would keep, to my knowledge, she would keep the black on. Like every night she would, of course, she would blot it and then keep it on, and she could hide behind that.
I find it an effort to keep up appearances. It takes so long, I'd rather be asleep. I'm really very hard to describe oneself anyway, because you don't see. I'm very short-sighted, as I said before. I'm constantly peering in mirrors, and people say, my God, isn't she conceited? And I'm actually not seeing anything. I mean, I can look in a mirror from here and I can't see. You know, see how much eye black I've got, and I can't see that. I just know I've got a lot of eye black, and I can't see the ends of my fingers from there.
She couldn't see people until they were really close up to her, which she used to say was an advantage, because she was so insecure of having to deal with people. And one of my favorite her expressions, never let yourself be too get attable. And she said, being in my position, being so short-sighted, it means that people really have to come close to me in order for me to recognize who they are. So if they're over there, I don't have to even worry about speaking to them, because I can't see them. She literally, her and Sandy Shaw were the two blindest pop singers of the 60s. Sandy Shaw was known for being barefoot. She should have been known for being partially blind as well, because she was so short-sighted, and so was Dusty. Poor thing. But she did use the makeup as a bit of a mask. I mean, everything was all part of a mask.
Hay quien todo cuando me ve pasar, chica, ¿dónde va? Voy de a bailar el bayón.
Let's take a trip in the trailer. No
need to come. With the transformation to glamorous star complete, Dusty would have a string of hits throughout the 60s and host her own television show. She seemed to be able to sing anything whilst remaining distinctively Dusty.
Everybody,
she was a great pop singer, a great soul singer, a great ballad singer, a great folk singer, a great jazz singer. She was so good at so many different things.
I trusted what she sang. It didn't make any difference if once in a while the note was a little sharp or a little bit flat. They were jewels. The way Dusty sang the libretto. It just was smoky, it was sexy, it was restrained, it was held in check, but underneath it was smoldering. You know, it was just on fire. It's just so much romance and passion and coolness too, you know.
When she sang one of those breathy songs, she sounded like a reed instrument. And it was such a fragile sound. But then she was capable of taking off and soaring above a great R&B song and being so powerful, you almost wouldn't believe it was the same woman singing.
Dubbed the Queen of Blue-Eyed Soul, Dusty was often assumed to be black by those who had heard but not seen her. She sometimes admitted to feeling like an imposter, but with a few exceptions, black musicians welcomed and respected her. She was a tireless promoter of black music, whether hosting the Cutting Edge television show, Ready, Steady, Go, or covering soul and Motown songs on her own show.
I think she was, if you scraped off the Irish Mary Isabel Catherine Bernadette O'Brien, she was black underneath. And that's what she found out.
Before Dusty, all British female singers really were still living in the 50s. Dusty changed it virtually overnight. Suddenly she was making records that sounded like they were made in America. She was singing like an American, but it didn't sound like an impression. It was the real thing.
Britain suddenly had a soul singer. People tend to forget that when you say soul singer, you don't mean that the person is black, you just mean that the person sings from there. That's what a soul singer is, you know, so soul singers don't really have a color.
Everybody knows that Dusty was mesmerized by black singers, that she just loved the Martha Reeves and the Aretha Franklins and the Dionne Warwicks. And there is a tremendously soulful, spiritual feeling, even though she wasn't raised in a Baptist church shaking a tambourine.
Music, sweet music, there'll be music.
There were other ladies who embraced our music and did cover versions. There was Cilla Black, there was Petula Clark, and there was Lulu of the Lovers that I can remember clearly doing our songs. However, Dusty was the one who got into the music and actually did cover versions and glorified the music. She was in awe of us, and we were in awe of her.
I come from a white bread English family who were brought up on sort of Gilbert and Sullivan and South Pacific, and I'd never heard a black singer, I mean truly in my life. And so Dusty was suddenly playing me these incredible black soul records, and I just went balmy, loved them. And over the course of Ready Steady, I had the opportunity obviously to book who I wanted, so I would book Otis Redding, Ike and Tina Turner, James Brown, and the Motown. We would play their records, and none of them had been to England, and they put together a Motown review. And so we did a special, and Dusty hosted it.
Wishing and hoping and thinking and praying.
She welcomed Smokey, and I think the Supremes weren't even heard of at that particular time. The Temptations with My Girl, oh, they were the stars of the show, if you ask me. Stevie Wonder did Fingertips, and we presented a very good show. The thrill of it all was singing the duet with Dusty. Wishing and hoping, and I think our voices blended so well. That was really a thrill. We were friends since then.
Dusty was cast as a hero of the anti-apartheid movement when her 1964 tour to South Africa provoked a political storm. Her contract stated she would play only to mixed audiences. Confronted with a sea of all white faces at a concert, Dusty rebelled. She was forced to abandon the tour and return home.
Why did you have this special anti-apartheid clause written into your contract? Do you feel strongly politically about this?
No, I don't know the first thing about politics. All I know is that I think that there shouldn't be anybody, if they want to buy a ticket, should be allowed to do so. And this was the agreement I went under.
Why was your contract different to previous ones? It was much stronger.
Well, I think that I may be wrong about this, but I think that in the case of most British artists who have been there before, they have played maybe one or two segregated concerts. And I didn't particularly want to do that.
Can I get a witness?
Dusty was not to become known for her politics, but the South African incident underlined her emerging reputation as a hellraiser. Her hot temper and goonish sense of humour meant that trouble followed her around. Dusty's outsider status was fueled by rumours about her sexuality, which were countered with carefully managed publicity that presented her both as straight and forever on the verge of romance. The flip side of success for Dusty was a punishing schedule of touring and recording, and right from the early days she suffered from nervous exhaustion. Her workload was increased by her hands-on approach.
I would see Dusty actually, you know, take charge, and I think people were not always happy about the fact that she was adamant about what she wanted and what she, you know, I've kind of got a bit more like that now, you know. But I admired that in her, and I loved that. I thought it as sort of as feistiness, not awkward at all.
It was hard, no doubt about it, because first of all, she's extremely musical, I mean, really musical, and knew sounds and knew what she wanted on her records, and of course was influenced by America. So she felt really strongly when she went into the studio that she wanted to get certain sounds which English musicians perhaps hadn't played before, arrangers hadn't really thought about, so she was constantly playing people bits of records and saying, this is what we should do, this is the sound we want, this is the echo.
I close my eyes and count to 10, and when I open them, you're still with me.
She would like for the bass player to use his finger to play and not a plectrum, because that's what she had seen in America. Little things that don't mean anything to most people were really important to her. But when she brought them over to the UK, a lot of musicians didn't like that. But she knew what she wanted.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me.
People never give women credit for knowing that they can get it, and Dusty really did. And in fairness, Johnny Franz, who was the producer, was excellent. I mean, he was older, and he was more than happy to sit back, put his feet up, and smoke his cigar, and let her get on with it.
And don't tell me what to do, and don't tell me what to say.
Everyone in Phillips, when you think about it, in the early 60s, the mid-60s, it was very male dominated. So for this so-called star to come along female telling us what to do wasn't really accepted. But that's why she got the reputation, and it's, she always used to say, when a man stands his ground, they go, yeah, he stood his ground. But when a woman stands her ground, she's a B-I-T-C-H.
I think my first consciousness of Dusty Springfield was driving to work one day in 1965 from Long Island into our Atlantic Records office in Manhattan, and I had the radio on, of course, and here comes this beautiful voice, and I hadn't heard it before, and it was mesmerizing. If I remember, the song I heard on the radio that day was Song of Your Loving. Her voice really struck me, and I knew that this was somebody very special.
I know a man likes to feel that he's been around before he decides to settle down. I've no doubt someday you're gonna feel that way too.
Attracted by Jerry Wexler's work with artists like Ray Charles and Aretha Franklin, Dusty teamed up with the legendary producer to make her next album, the classic Dusty in Memphis. But it was to be a rocky road.
So we scheduled for American Studios and in Memphis. The band was brilliant, but much to my dismay, Dusty absolutely would not sing a note. I don't know how many days we spent in Memphis. Probably was about 2 weeks. She just wouldn't sing.
Jerry's gone in print as saying, I'm the most insecure singer he's ever come across. And at that time, he was quite right. What he didn't realize, I think, was how intimidated I was. Because they were telling stories and talking about Aretha, and I'm going, why are they recording me? And that showed in the time that it took to get vocal performances out of me.
We ended up in New York in a hired studio on 57th Street, and that's where we did the vocals, and there were just Arif, Tom Dowd, and myself. in there to work with her. And there was one, during one song, I had a duck a flying ashtray. I haven't told that before. I don't think I put it down.
Just don't forget about me now, baby. Baby,
Dusty had the stigmata of perfectibility. So when she did perform, she was afraid to let it go because her standards were so high and it might not come out exactly right.
Just a little love early in the morning.
There was an element in me that always often thought I was a sham anyway. It took a lot to break that down, that critic in me. And they did it. I mean, they got it out of me somehow.
I don't wanna hear of anybody.
She contravened all the received and perceived notions of how to do a vocal, because the band is finished and she has her earphones on. And Dusty kept calling for more track, more track. And finally it reached the point I couldn't believe it. She's doing a vocal and said, give me more track, I can still hear myself. Well, imagine, she wanted so much track that she couldn't hear the vocal that she was projecting at the time. I can't imagine how she did it, how she stayed in tune, stayed in time, and also sang with Dusty Springfield's personality and created these marvelous vocals.
Billy Ray was a preacher's son, and when his daddy would visit, he'd come along. When they get around and started talking, Dust and Billy would take me walking. Out through the backyard we go walking. Then he'd look into my eyes. Lord knows to my surprise, the only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man. The only one who could ever teach me was the son of a preacher man. Yes, he was. He was. Oh, yes, he was.
If you left it to her, I don't think half her material would have been released. She was always striving to be better and saying, oh, I'd like to have sung that like Aretha sung it, you know. Her own stuff was never good enough. She always came away going, could have done that better.
You've been crying, your face is a mess. Come in, baby. You can dry the tears on my dress. She's hurt you again, I can tell. Oh, I know that look so well. Don't be shy.
In 1970, Dusty gave an interview to Ray Connolly of the London Evening Standard, in which she admitted her bisexuality for the first time. Though many have claimed that she was simply a lesbian, Dusty was adamant that she would not be confined by other people's categories.
Felt that the whole gay scene was very open. I mean, there was never any problem with it. For non-stars, it was absolutely fine. But I think for the business, nothing's changed. It's just the same today. I mean, I think there are a lot of people who don't announce their sexuality because it's not good for business.
Although she has gone public on two or three occasions, I sometimes had the impression that she wished she hadn't. And although I actually believe she would have been a happier person if she had been absolutely clear and gotten the subject out of the way, she obviously couldn't do it for whatever reason. And I think that was a pity.
I think maybe, if she did find out she was bisexual, I think she would have thought, oh, that's against my religion. And I think maybe that's why she became a lapsed Catholic. And I think it made her more introvert about it. She always felt guilty. She always felt guilty.
Well, I don't know if she would have been as brave as Ellen DeGeneres, but she certainly was as outrageous, or would like to have been, I think, as outrageous as Madonna on occasion has been. I think the outrageousness of certain people really appealed to her.
Dusty's love of the outrageous, and a public persona that at once suggested and hid her own sexuality, ensured her status as a gay icon. Her camp wit was to land her in trouble when she gave a concert in front of Princess Margaret at the Royal Albert Hall in 1979. By then, Simon Bell had become her backing singer.
Dusty noticed that the audience really was largely gay, certainly the people at the front. And she made a remark that it was nice to see that the royalty wasn't confined to the box. And apparently Princess Margaret didn't like that. I find it very hard to believe that Princess Margaret hasn't had a sense of humor. But apparently she was not amused. A letter came from St. James's Palace instructing Dusty that she had to sign an apology for having insulted the crown. Dusty signed it. I was very surprised. That proves that she's not quite the hellraiser that maybe we would all think.
This is really for all the people who have been legends in their time, I'm sure you know. Sometimes the ladies that I'm speaking of give too much of themselves. Sometimes not enough. This song is really for all those people, all those women, no matter where they are.
She was a great dramatic singer, you know, so she fitted into the mold drawn by Judy Garland. And later, when she wasn't at her peak vocally, there was always that element, was she going to make it or not, which was again drawing on the same source as Judy. So it was easy to see why she was going to be a gay icon, you know. And she made wonderful, heart-rending songs that a certain kind of gay man and woman loved to sit and listen to, you know.
Quietly, there's a lady on stage. She may not be the latest rage, but she's singing, and she means it. That deserves a little silence. Why, God, please, there's a woman up there. She's been honest through her songs.
She was a diva. And the fact that, you know, she wasn't easy to deal with, and the vulnerability. That appeals to gay people because they see a bit of themselves in those people, and they're a bit tortured. And she was a bit tortured.
Put your hands together, help her along. All that's left of the singers, that's left of the song.
Well, there's two things make Dusty a gay icon. I mean, firstly, the music, and then, of course, the look. You know, Dusty made some remark in the 1980s. She said, well, I must be getting popular again because the drag queens are doing me. And she really liked that, by the way.
She was just camp. That's what attracted them. They all, every drag queen wanted to look like her, didn't they, really? I can't tell you how many parties I've been to with some drag queen who'd turn up dressed like her.
I mean, she was a camp icon. And also the hand movements, the whole sort of package, you know. At Dusty's funeral, Lulu told this fantastic story. Apparently, Dusty developed that because she used to write the song lyrics on her arm.
Oh, well, I used to love it where she would go. I mean, I don't know, I can't remember which song, but just say it would be, where did our love lie? In the middle of nowhere, because she'd like forget the next. That's probably not a good example, but she would have the words written up her arms, she'd have them all over her hands. There was pen, ink everywhere, and you know, because she'd forget lines and things like that, which we all do. But hers was so obvious. But she turned it into a kind of a. This was her movement. There did our love fly, and she'd do that. And of course, because she was partly blind, she'd have to go right up to her nose.
If I give up,
yes, I'm
backing
up.
Moving out of town,
moving out of town.
Pack it up,
yes, I'm backing
up. Moving out of town,
moving out of town.
I'm not chained, I'm no longer bound. Still I'm backing up.
Dusty had left England at the start of the 70s. Her sales were dropping. She had a horror of ending up on the nostalgia circuit, and she wanted to escape the prying into her sexuality. With her enduring love of both the American pop scene and Hollywood movies, Dusty felt the time had come to pursue her American dreams.
She got an American manager who said he could do this, he could do that. But when she got there, what she found was they had no idea what type of artist she was. They thought she was somebody like another Peggy Lee who sat down at the piano or had a pianist there and just sang over the chink of glasses in the nightclub. Well, of course, that wasn't Dusty at all. That wasn't her scene.
She's a sweetheart, except when she's moody, it's hard to get through to her then.
I think because she'd been so big in England, and it had been relatively easy, and I think she thought that that was going to happen in America, and she was inherently lazy, and when it didn't happen immediately, I think she just went, shit, you know, this isn't so easy, I'm going to try and find another way. And you know how time goes, you think you've got all the time in the world, and you really don't, and suddenly, you know, it's too late for that.
She might take a drink with the housework, or when Michael's get late at the shop, a martini or two before dinner, but she always knows when to stop.
I think what went wrong was a combination. I think, yes, it was bad management, but I also think it was simple. It was the drugs and the drink. I mean, she was impossible. So with the best will in the world, you know, nobody could have really helped her, made her do things. Her decisions were wonky. I mean, they just weren't right.
I'm hearing all these stories coming back from different sources. And I must own up, I did sometimes feel guilty and think, I wish I had gone because I might possibly have made a difference. On the other hand, I might not have, and I'd have had to watch it. And quite honestly, I'd rather have not seen that period of her life.
She was doing the dishes when a glass fell and broke on the tile. She cut her wrist quite by mistake. It was real touch and go for a while.
A part of me was always worried when you, like when you would pass the newspaper stands and you'd see a pop star or famous star, something tragic had happened to them. I always expected to see something like that because she was also a self-destructive type person as well. So.
In the hills above Los Angeles, the wildlife way station takes in abused and neglected animals. It became a place of sanctuary for Dusty too, in what are known as her lost years. After her albums of the early 70s met with indifference, she mostly dropped out of the music scene for several years and turned her attention to the women's tennis circuit and the Beverly Hills party circuit. Increasingly depressed, she attempted to replace the highs of stardom with alcohol, mandrax, and cocaine. Eventually, she attempted suicide several times. Dusty met Helene Sellery in 1976 at an alcoholics support group. Helene was on hand when Dusty started recording again in the late 70s, and together they were frequent visitors to the Wildlife Way station.
If I had to say where her heart was in California, it would be here, you know. This was peace and quiet for her, and it was, you know, one-to-one rapport with animals. I mean, yes, she had her cats and adored them, you know. But this was something very special, and she would come to get kind of renewed here. She would sit in front of the cat cages for hours, just absolute silence. And she would try to mimic their sounds, you know. When I first knew her, she said, you know, it gets lonely in the studios, and there's always a lot of cocaine, and there's a lot of champagne around. And I'd appreciate it if you'd, you know, come during rehearsals. And I did for 2.5 albums, you know. And she rehearsed from 6 p.m. until about 4 a.m., which was in part why they said she was difficult.